project I'm going to tell you about tonight sits firmly at the crossroads of where we are today, both as a nation and internationally. The Intercultural Storytelling Project is designed to bring cultures together. I can see that you're probably looking at the subheading at the bottom of the screen and thinking, is he serious? Banter can change the world. Now, we know that Irish people know, particularly after a couple of pints, we solve all the world's problems and then go home. And then we wake up the next morning and find that they're still there. But banter and stories and yarns are at the center of who we are as human beings and what we do. The giant of cognitive psychology, Jerome Bruner, famously said that narrative is the way we organize human events and make sense of them. Barbara Hardy, the poet and literary scholar, went further. We dream in narrative. We daydream in narrative. We grieve in narrative. We criticize in narrative. We love and we hate and so on. All of these human events are organized in stories. Every day you're doing it. Who walked in when I was over there the other day only? And the narrative begins. And we organize our lives around these. And we make sense of it. We are storied beings. The Intercultural Storytelling Project harnesses that human superpower to build bridges between communities. And this is what we're trying to do with the project. This is a map of Dublin from the 2011 census. We've not one available from the 2016, but it won't have changed that much. The dark red pockets, it represents the population in terms of Irish or non-Irish born. The non-Irish born are the darker pockets. Up to, if you get to the darker pockets, you have 7 out of 10 in population are non-Irish born in some areas in Dublin. So this is a stark new reality that Irish people are having to come to terms with, and the people who are arriving are coming to terms with as well. I did my research in one of the darker pockets, my doctoral research in Tallaght in Dublin, and I was very interested in the lived experiences of the new Irish that were coming in. What I did in this research was I got them to tell stories, not myths or legends or fairy tales. I wanted their life stories. So I was using their life stories to understand what was happening with them. At the same time, and I'm an applied linguist, which means I'm interested in how people learn languages, I was interested in building up their literacy through the same stories. So we have two things happening there at the same time. What these stories revealed when I was collecting them were, and there are many other researchers in the world doing similar. We call it narrative inquiry. Narrative inquiry is simply looking at people's stories and trying to understand their lives. What came back out of the stories was postcards from the edge of social exclusion. So we had particular groups among these people. Women, there was a big gender element. Women were managing, women we called the bridge builders in terms of moving into new countries and setting up new lives. Women are at the forefront. They have their families, they're the carers. So you had women caring for extensive families. One woman was caring for a 90-year-old mother-in-law and her grandchild and the rest of the family, meanwhile holding down a job, and she was slipping into the local library, into the children's section, to learn English. So you have these people that are on the edge and struggling to make sense of a new social system. So you have people that are trying to make sense of a new educational system for their children, trying to make sense of how do I talk to a doctor in a language I don't know? How do I talk to my teachers, the teacher of my child, and all of those social systems that are new, they are parachuted into a new social system. Also, we imagine that these communities, and I'm sure there may be some people among the communities here tonight, we imagine that they're a homogenous whole, that somehow all of the Polish people know each other, and all of the Chinese people are hanging out together over there, and all of the kind of the Latvians are over here, and they're all cool together, and everything's happening. It's cool. In my research, this turned out not to be always the case. One Chinese lady I was talking to, we have a big Chinese New Year festival in Dublin, she had been in Dublin for 4 years. And I said, so you go to the Chinese New Year? She said, never heard of it. I said, so do you socialize outside your family? Nope. So the only two or three people she was socializing with were her husband, her child, and her mother-in-law. So what we have here are people who are separated from the host community, which is us, or Ireland, but also segregated from their own community. So you have what's called a double dislocation, which is a double separation. They're separated doubly. And this is quite challenging. While all this is happening with our new communities, and only to some members of it, we must be clear, some people are very happily settled in and, integrated and it's all going well, but there are people I've met that aren't, it isn't going well. But while all that's happening, in the communities themselves, more settled members, let's call them, of the communities, they're kind of suffering a little bit of a siege. And there's been research into this, particularly in Dublin. They've kind of done research with the people in the local communities, and they feel a little bit under pressure. You could almost say there's a certain amount of social exclusion for them as well, if you wanted to push it far enough. And they have a mistrust of newcomers. So these two things are happening obviously contemporaneously. And I was looking for a way, when I had worked with my migrants, I thought, okay, we can use these stories in another way. How could we get the stories? Could we put them together with members of the local community and get both of them to share their lived experiences? And how would that work? How would I be able to do that? I had built a model based on our newcomers. Would it work with us? Would we be able to sit down with them and share those stories? I tried it out. This is the kitchen of a small community center in Dublin, the Barbara Ward Community Center, in Dublin 3, which is one of those pockets where you have up to 7 out of 10 people that may not be born in Ireland. And this is Kathleen and Ajit sitting down there and other people. Now, I tried this out. I said, okay, let's put them down and see if we can get stories together. So what's happening here is Kathleen is telling her story to Ajit in the foreground. Ajit is taking notes of her story. And Kathleen does the same about his story. So they are co-authoring or co-writing their stories. They go home with the notes they've taken. They write it out. And then they come back the next week, read what's happened the week before, examine and make sure it's all okay. Now, what's happening here, what intercultural storytelling does, is it's community building, to start off with. It is building up the people from the new communities, it's building up their literacy and their English language skills, quite powerfully, actually. And for the people of the more settled community, it is informing them of the lived experience of the person in front of them. What happens from that is these two people then go back into their communities, such as they are, and they relate, oh, the other day I met Ajit and he told me this story and, you know, and it was really amazing. And so it's bleeding back into the communities, into both communities for a start. And this, we're kind of hitting two birds with the one stone here. So that's social exclusion on the one side from our new Irish friends, and the kind of mistrust and siege of our local community, we're kind of tearing that apart. We're disrupting it. It's very simple to administer this storytelling. Themes are given out every week. So I give them this storytelling, this particular cycle went on for 12 weeks. And we would meet for 2 hours. And it's nice because it's a kitchen. If anybody wants to try this out, I would recommend the kitchen. The kitchen is where all the stories were told. When I grew up, everything happened in the kitchen. All the stories from the family, from other people outside, they all come into the kitchen, it always happened there. What happened then is you have a very powerful moment happening when two people sit down for 2 hours a week and listen and record each other's stories. A very powerful bond builds up between them for a start. It's something we probably don't do an awful lot of in the modern world is listen. We're busy talking, we're busy consuming, we're busy doing all those things. But the act of listening is such a powerful act. In this situation, it has a very powerful effect on the people that are involved in it. In those communities, I meet people, when I tell them about my job and what I do, they, in Dublin, they go, why aren't you walking with our people? Why are you walking with them? That's what I want. Invariably, with this sort of project, I can answer, well, actually, you're involved in this. This is you. So we are helping you as well. You are socially excluded. These are areas of our city and our towns around Ireland as well that are socially excluded themselves, that have been neglected for a long time, that may have their own problems and their own issues. So it is a two-way model. And in fact, the Council of Europe, the stated position on integration is a two-way model. I cannot ask somebody, oh, he should be integrating with us. Why is he not integrating with us? It's a two-way system. I have to go and meet the other. I have to know the other's experience before passing any judgment. And this storytelling, particularly because it's biographical, and the very deep stuff comes up. I remember one of my participants was leaving this room. She's from Cabra in Dublin, Marie. We'll meet her in a moment. And she says, well, Peter, this is like therapy. And it is a form of social therapy. I'm not saying, I don't want to go near any of the other stuff because that way lies madness. But it is a social therapy where people sit, they have cups of tea, and you can see they're all relaxed. And you can see they're quite vibrant. It's a lot happening in the room. The only expertise needed for this activity is that human superpower of banter, stories. This is Sylvia and Nasu. And one of the frames, the themes we use for storytelling is something called a biopoem. And I might have to go back a frame there to show you what a biopoem is. It's not coming up. A biopoem is simply a set of instructions. All of our narrative frames, they're called narrative frames, and I give them the narrative frames. It is a set of instructions of what you need to do, a topic, a theme. The biopoem is a set of instructions about, tell me your first name. Tell me three things you like. Tell me something about your experiences. Tell me how you feel about recent experiences. And so Sylvia and Nasu, this is Sylvia writing about Nasu's biopoem. And it's called Nasu's biopoem. Nasu, whose name means advisor, who is peaceful and wise, father of Mahraf, husband of Falak, who loves learning English, stubbornly, who loves learning about other cultures around the world, who is always worried about Syria and its people, but feels happy to be a survivor, who is scared of losing those he loves, who is proud of his son, and of himself for learning English, who hopes to see peace in his country and no hunger anywhere in the world, who lives in Marino, Hosari. So the biopoem starts off with your first name, then goes through those things about who you are. So it's an identity snapshot. It gives us a quick picture, but quite a deep picture. This was our storyteller's favorite theme. All of my storytellers said they loved this because it brought them very close to a person in a very, very, very short space of time. Now, that is Sylvia and Nasu. I'm going to do the opposite now. I'm going to introduce you to two more of our storytellers. Marie and Marek. Marie is from Cabra, where I come from in Dublin, and Marek is from Poland. And this is Marek's photograph of Marie. Marie's biopoem. Marie, who is determined, creative, generous, who is partner to Bernard, who loves sunsets, early morning birdsong, and grandchildren, who feels exhausted, energized, and surprised, who is scared of loneliness, ignorance, and the universe, who has established long-lasting friendships in Madagascar, who wants to continue to be creative, to travel and celebrate life, who lives in Cabra, Neary, and that's her surname. So people are getting very close in these encounters, even though the first encounter, I remember the first time we did this together, these were people who had never met before in their lives from different cultures, but yet we're able to sit down and use this superpower, this banter superpower, to become close. And that is something that we possibly use more in our lives. This is Lara and Kitman. Kitman is from Iraq. Lara is an English woman living in East Wall in Dublin. So the idea of having somebody local, they don't have to be local, fifth generation Dubliner, you know what I mean? They can be people who are more settled locally. So I remember this, Lara said to me, but I'm not Irish, I can't tell about it. No. You are more settled, you're bringing the other person into the fire. You're nearer the fire, you bring them into the fire. And that's the way it works. Built into my stories, I asked them to reflect on their stories. I said, look, one of the themes I gave them, I said, look, can you tell me? I wanted to know what was happening with them, what was happening in their telling, what was happening in them inside their telling, because I couldn't always eavesdrop on it. And Kitman here, this is Kitman's feedback. And of course, for somebody who's learning English, this is a very powerful way of improving your language skills and your literacy skills. But also, Kitman uses an interesting word here, socialized. And this is exactly what we were aiming at, trying to socialize people and learning from friends' stories, because stories are the way we learn, very simply. So all of this was happening. Other impacts that have come out of the intercultural storytelling experience are it's spreading. It's spreading pretty quickly because it's so simple to do. Dublin City University, the intercultural faculty, Dr. Veronica Crosby, having found out about this, came to me and set up an intercultural storytelling in Dublin City University. She took 25 refugees from Mosny, and these people are really isolated. Here we're into real social exclusion, and brought them into the campus of Dublin City University, which is the first university of sanctuary in Ireland. I think Limerick has just become a university of sanctuary. And we did the storytelling with them. And you can imagine if you're stuck out in Mosny and suddenly you go in and this happens. You can imagine the impact that's having, both on the people that are being brought out of direct provision, but also the people that meet them. So that's that two-way model, that human superpower at work. Other impacts are Neil McArdle up in Dundalk, very, very cleverly put the storytelling together with photography about the new Irish in Dundalk, and then put on an exhibition, which again is pushing it out into the community. So here we are, this is what we want. It happens in the room, but we want it to happen outside the room as well. So that's happening. The Interfaith Forum in Dublin have approached me, and they now want to use it among young people of diverse faiths, so they can build up tolerance and understanding between their diverse beliefs. And that's, I have a meeting next week with Adrian from the Interfaith Forum, and we're going to push that forward. After I gave a talk about this in Dublin, one lady came up to me who was working with recovering addicts. And she said, well, this looks like something I could use. So it's an adaptable tool. It is a very powerful tool as well. A very obvious one. I think, why haven't we thought about this before? Why wasn't I doing this 40 years ago or how many years ago? And it solves a problem in a very, very simple way. So I'll ask you to leave you with, you can change it into faith, into human, into cultural, any way you want. If you see somewhere you need understanding, all of the tools are available on our website, and you can get it through TED, and use that superpower of banter to change the world. Thank you.